So I will start the session with a prayer.
Yes, Maharaj.
स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। नमस्कार टू ऑल ऑफ यू, वेलकम टू द डिस्कशन ऑन ग्रेट मास्टर श्री रामकृष्ण और लीला प्रसंग बाय शारदानंद जी महाराज। इन द इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट टू द डिवाइन इनकार्नेशन एज स्पिरिचुअल साधका, we were now reading a chapter called Sadhaka and Sadhana. Sadhaka is a spiritual aspirant, a mumukshu who wants to get liberation or realize God. Then sadhana are the spiritual practices by which we can reach our goal, that is God realization. So yesterday, Shardanandaji Maharaj had brought us up to the path of devotion. Shardanandaji Maharaj tells, we have designated the path of devotion as the path of this. For although the traveler on this path has the actual knowledge of the transience of the world, he believes in God, its creator, and has the conviction of the reality and existence of the world created by him. The devotee looks upon the world and all things and persons in it as related with God and makes them his own. He shuns whatever he believes to be an obstacle on the path leading to the realization of that relation. It becomes the devotee's immediate ideal to become absorbed in him through the love of and meditation on one of his forms, and also to perform all actions out of love for him. We shall now discuss how one can, forgetting the existence of the universe, reach the nirvikalpa state of consciousness by being absorbed in the meditation of forms of God. Now Shardanandaji Maharaj is telling, we shall now discuss how one can, forgetting the existence of the universe, reach the nirvikalpa state of consciousness by being absorbed in meditation on the forms of God. We have said before that the devotee accepts as his chosen ideal some particular form of God and continues to think of and meditate on that form. He cannot in the beginning bring before his mind's eye at the time of meditation the complete picture of the person of his chosen ideal. Sometimes the hands of the mental picture, sometimes the feet, and sometimes only the face appears before him. Now you can go back to your meditation. While you are meditating on the form of your chosen ideal, what happens? Shardanandaji Maharaj is telling, because it is not intensified, the devotee, when he accepts as his chosen ideal some particular form of God and continues to think of and meditate on that form, he cannot, in the beginning, bring before his mind's eye at the time of meditation the complete picture of the person of his chosen ideal. Sometimes the hands of that mental picture, sometimes the feet, and sometimes only the face appears before him. These again dissolve as it were. As soon as they are seen, they do not continue to stand before him as a result of practice. So when it dissolves, when you don't get the form, when you get only a part of the Ishta Devata while meditating, Do not be aggrieved. Do not be worried. It's natural. As you go on practicing, then it becomes firmer and firmer. So that's what Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is taking, how you will be forgetting the external world by the meditation of the chosen ideal. So these again dissolve as it were. As soon as they are seen, they do not continue to stand before him. As a result of practice, when meditation becomes deep, the complete picture of that form appears before his mind's eye. When meditation gradually becomes deeper, the picture presents itself to him in vivid and unbroken continuity as long as the mind remains steady and unswerving. Afterwards, according to the progress in the intensity of meditation, the devotee becomes conscious of the movement. Now you can see, as you progress, as the meditation becomes deeper and deeper, what happens? The picture, earlier it was a picture, it was not picture. After, according to the progress in the intensity of meditation, the devotee becomes conscious of the movement, the smile, the speech, and ultimately the touch of that living form. So I'll read it again. It's very important because most of us, 99.99% are devotees who want to worship God with form and attributes. So now, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is so nicely taking so many questions of our mind, so many doubts of our mind are being answered in this chapter. That's why I'm taking the introduction to the divine incarnation as a sadhaka, and particularly this chapter, sadhaka and sadhana. Sadhaka, we know we are all sadhakas, the spiritual aspirants. And sadhana is which we are performing. The sadhaka performs certain spiritual practices, and that's called sadhana. So this chapter is so very important because it is describing, it is taking us through all the different problems, doubts, and states of our mind. While as sadhakas we are moving forward, we face all these things. So we are eager to know. So now so nicely, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is taking us through all the stages of spiritual practice so nicely, and it is very helping us and so many clearing so many doubts of ours. Now, you should note, very, very important, afterwards, according to the progress in the intensity of meditation, mind it, it's very, very important, as you go progress, the devotee becomes conscious of the movement, the smile of the deity in your heart. It becomes animated. It becomes living. The Lord will smile in your heart. The speech, you can talk to God within your heart. And ultimately, the touch of that living form also you can feel. Then the devotee sees with his eyes open or shut. This is still wonderful. Then the devotee sees with his eyes open or shut the benign and living presence of the Lord and his graceful movements everywhere and in all conditions. So beautiful, so enriching, so inspiring. Then the devotee sees with his eyes graceful movements everywhere and in all conditions. The devout aspirant gradually comes to have also the visions of various divine forms springing from his own chosen, from his own chosen ideal as the result of his faith, that his chosen ideal has out of his own accord assumed all the other forms. Now we'll come to know. Your own chosen ideal will start showing all the other different forms, whereby you will understand. Now, even though, see, now we have not had any visions of this type, or our meditation has become deeper, but by the experience, one of the experience of one of the greatest direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, whom our Holy Mother had mentioned, Shardanandaji Maharaj, as a very great spiritual aspirant of the highest order. Sharda Devi used to tell about this Shardanandaji Maharaj, that you go search all the three worlds. Here, three worlds means generally in Gayatri Mantra we use Bhur Bhuva Swaha, because it is 24-lettered mantra. 24-lettered means that is the Gayatri Chandas, the meter. Just like there is Anushtup Chandas, then Trishtup Chandas. There are so many meters while constructing poetry. Likewise in Sanskrit, these are all meters. Gayatri is the name of a meter. It is not the name of the mantra. Because for the first time, the meter was discovered, so it is called Gayatri Mantra. Otherwise, the real name of that mantra is Savitri Mantra, Savitru Mandala Madhyavarti, the Srishtikarta, the creator god. Savitri means, Savitru means the creator god. So, but somehow, because the meter was the first time revealed to Vishwamitra in that mantra with 24 letters, so it was that name Gayatri has stuck to it. But in reality, it is Savitru Mantra. Never mind, let us not go to those things. Now coming back, they're all meters. So likewise, you can see here, the chosen ideal assumes different forms. When you have faith, the devout aspirant gradually comes to have all the visions of various divine forms springing from his own chosen ideal as a result of his faith. That his chosen ideal has out of his own accord assumed all these forms. So you will come to know your own chosen ideal has assumed all the different forms of different gods and goddesses. So the chosen ideal, whichever you have chosen now, will start giving you visions of different gods and goddesses, whereby you will come to know that they are all the same one God, your own chosen ideal, your own Atman, your own consciousness, awareness, the Parabrahma Swarupa which is within you, taking all these different forms. So now you have got answer to so many questions of yours, that in Hinduism there are all those 330 million gods and goddesses, and now so many saints, so many much more gods and goddesses are being included. What are all these things? So you can now come to know that your own chosen ideal, that is one God, has taken all those different forms to suit the need of the age, need of the time, to help the spiritual aspirant of different evolution or different tastes and natures, to help them go up in spiritual life. He has taken all these forms. So now he will show you all these forms as you go deeper and deeper into meditation. So that important aspect of the chosen ideal, meditation of the chosen ideal in the path of devotion, is being expressed here. The devout aspirant will gradually come to know, come to have the visions of various divine forms. So there is only one God. Hinduism is not advocating multiple gods or many gods. It's only one God. But the same one God is taking different forms, different name, to suit the tastes of different people, to suit the need of the age, So different attributes are needed. It's the same sweet, but all of us do not like to eat the same sweet of sugar or jaggery or some gram dal flour as only jalebi or jahangir or some other sweet. They want to taste the same thing in different shapes, different forms and different fragrance because of our inner samskaras. So the Lord, knowing all these things, our weaknesses, He will assume different forms, different attributes, just to please us, just to lift us to His, so that we like those things. Through that He will lift us to His state, higher state, the formless and attributeless state, the same one God. So now you are seeing how I was telling that Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling all these things because he was one of the greatest disciples. I told that Mother Sharada Devi told, go and search all the three worlds. I told only why three worlds. In our listing system here, there may be so many universes, so many galaxies. We human beings are living in this Surya Mandala, in this solar system, or in our this plane of existence. There may be different existences also, just like Divine Mother is called Akhilanda Koti Brahmanda Janani. Koti, koti means millions and billions of different living beings and different lokas, different things may be there. But in our, this solar system here, we have 14 worlds. Earth is the center. Earth means here, don't think that according to the planetary system, according to the plane of existence, I'm telling. Don't take it physically. So the human beings where we live, this is the center. It is this Mother Earth is holding on the other things. Above, there are seven lokas. Not seven, six. Including Earth, it becomes seven. What are they? Bhuhu, bhuvaha, suvaha, tapaha. Bhuhu, bhuvaha, suvaha, tapaha, janaha, satya loka, like that, seven. Below Earth is atala, pitala, rasatala, talatala, patala, like that, seven lokas are there. So, in all the lokas here, three lokas means when you cannot tell all the 14 lokas' name. Now you have shortage of time. What will you tell if there are 15 boys or 15 girls there? You will tell one name, some important person. This person, so-and-so, and all the others. Likewise here, all the three worlds means all these 14 worlds. You go and search. You will not find a person better than Sharadananda in his large-heartedness, a spiritual aspirant, a man of realization, a spiritual aspirant with large-heartedness. You cannot find another person in all these 14 worlds. Then one more thing she adds. He is in large-heartedness, in spiritual development. He is next only to Swami Vivekananda. That was the statement of Holy Mother. So in just one stroke, she's showing us both that what is the greatness of Swami Vivekananda, how big a large-hearted person, encompassing so much of compassion, so much of love for the human beings, that is large-heartedness. So if you have to move forward in spiritual life, what are the necessities? I told basics of spiritual life is perfect self-abnegation, removal of ego, removal of your selfishness. Then another aspect is being shown here. How much compassion, how much love, how much service do you have for the living beings? The creation of this world. Just like in Vedanta, the highest dictum of Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta is Brahma Satya Jagan Mithya. God alone is true. This whole appearance, the world which is appearing, is untrue. And what is the other dictum which is very, very important? Jiva Brahma Eva Naparaha. Jiva Brahma Eva Naparaha. What is the meaning of that? There is no higher God than living beings. So thrilling to hear. There is no higher God or goddesses than living beings. That is the highest dictum. So all gods and goddesses are staying in this microcosm. Yesterday I was telling about macrocosm and microcosm, Pindanda and Brahmanda. So this individual microcosm in us, this living being, encompasses the whole macrocosm in you. It is there. In me, in all the living beings, the whole macrocosm is hidden. So they are formed in the same form, in the way. Just like, see, the whole Ishvara, the Lord of this universe, encompasses all these world universes and so many millions of universes and galaxies and other things in his body. Lord, the Ishvara will encompass all those things. Now, you also are no less than that. You are also encompassing the whole universe in you, just like the Ishvara. You are a miniature Ishvara. That is a Brahma. That's why it is called Paramatma. You are called Atma. You are a reflection of that. The whole, this thing is encompassed in you too, in me too. So this is the microcosm, Pindanda. That is the Brahmanda. So I'll just give you an example. See, so many galaxies, so many living beings in that one living being called Ishvara or the Lord. And in you, in me, so many cells are there. Trillions and trillions of cells, living beings are there. Bacteria are there living in you. Just one muscles or one tissue, one type of tissue has so many billions of cells, living cells. They have ego, they are separate existence. The muscle cells, they behave in a different way. They do the different work. The heart muscle does a different work. The pancreas does different work. The cells there, the brain cells do the different work. The eye cells different. They are all living. And they are working for this one being in you. They are working for you. A person called you. Millions and billions and trillions of cells, different living beings are working for you. So many bacteria, so many viruses which are in you. They are all working for you. You are that one person, but you are not aware. But Ishvara is aware of his greatness. We have forgotten our greatness, that's all. That is the only difference. So this is a microcosm, that is a macrocosm. Another example of microcosm and macrocosm I'm going to give is, now take the miniature, the atoms. When you're breaking this matter, I've started breaking the living beings into the cells, smallest one. And the biggest is Shiva. So that's why in Vedanta it is called, while describing about God, they told that he is the biggest of the biggest. No, they do both the things. Anoraniyan mahato mahiyan. He's smallest of the smallest and bigger than the biggest. That is the way the Lord is described. The Lord is described in the Upanishads or in the our scriptures in Vedas as anoraniyan. He's smaller than the atom. Mahato mahiyan. Bigger than the biggest. So now break this in chemistry. You go to break this matter. So it will be broken. I told you it yesterday. It took it to atoms. We have broken up to the subatomic particles. Now see the functioning. The nucleus is just like similar to the sun or the stars, around which so many electrons based on different molecules or based on different materials. There may be different number of electrons and there will be different number of valence electrons too, which are ready to jump and make chemical reactions. So likewise, you see the nucleus and around which in the elliptical order, just like the sun or the stars and around which so many planets are going, at the biggest level, the smallest level too, it is very similar. And at the biggest level too, it is very similar. So I used to imagine, it will start railing my head if you start imagining. I don't know whether you will understand this, my thoughts or not. Now, if you take the smallest of the smallest, just like the nucleus and the electrons revolving around it, it is just like another solar system or planet, one atom. Now, imagine there may be living beings just like we are living on this earth in the solar system. In one atom, it may be like a sun or a star, and there may be in that electrons or just like similar to planet, there may be millions and trillions and billions of living beings living there in very miniature things, then go down and down and down and down, smaller, smaller, smaller. Now, in the bigger aspect, the solar system, we have this sun, the star, one of the stars around which the planet is going around. And this may be just like an atom there in all these materials or substances. We have atoms, so many atoms. Likewise, what is one of our solar system? This may be an atom of something bigger being. And go on bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. I used to get this concept when I used to go to the barber shop and see a mirror in front of me, and there would be another mirror behind me. And so there will be multiple reflections here going in forward, multiple this way. Multiple images of mine seeing deeper and deeper, and behind also it will go deeper and deeper. I would get confused. So something like that. Anoraniyan, Mahatomahiyan. Is bigger than the biggest, smaller than the smallest, macrocosm and microcosm. So you are the microcosm. You encompass me, everyone, all the living beings are so great that we encompass the whole universe. Whatever you see, the biggest universe is encompassed in you, but you are not aware. Only Ishvara is aware. Only the difference between Jiva and Shiva is aware of his greatness. We are not aware of our greatness. We have been made to, by the Maya, to think that we are limited. Now, such a great personality whom Sharda Devi, Mother, Divine Mother Sharda Devi is telling that you go and search all these worlds. You will not find one more great aspirant bigger than him. In large-heartedness, he is next only to Swami Vivekananda. So you can see what is the state of Swami Vivekananda. Why have they got this greatness? Though there may be so many millions of aspirants who have got realization, you become bigger. Even there, knowledge will vary. Your knowledge of Parabrahman will vary according to the heart you have. So the more large-hearted you are, the more bigger an aspirant. It varies in degrees. Even in the people who have realized God, they have degrees of Brahmagnana or that knowledge. So amongst them, that's why amongst the devatas or this thing, Ganesha is called Vinayaka. Nanayako esya saha Vinayaka. No more higher leader than Ganesha amongst gods and goddesses and all the realized souls, because he had that highest knowledge. Likewise here, Sharda Devi is telling, go and search all the three worlds. You will not find an aspirant with large-heartedness, realization than Shardananda. He is next only to Swami Vivekananda. So such a person is giving us all the experiences here. So it is not hocus-pocus or bogus. It is true. It is his own experience, how he has gone forward. He is telling us. So it's all true. So he's taking us through all those experiences because he has had all those things. So whatever he's saying about us now, we will also undergo all those things. So have faith. Go forward in spiritual life. It's very, very beneficial and helpful when we hear all those things. It will give us faith. Yes, we are going to get this. So what is Shardanandaji Maharaj is telling? The devout aspirant gradually comes to have also the visions of various divine forms. And where is it coming from? Springing from his own chosen ideal. That same biggest Lord, whom you call Ishvara or God or Atman or Paramatman, whatever you may call, is hidden in you. That biggest God is within you. You need not go on searching, looking at the sky. He's within you. He's more nearer than your father and mother. He's more nearer than your own body. You are a part of him. So, Shardanandaji Maharaj is taking through all those things. The devout aspirant gradually comes to have also the visions of various divine forms springing from his own chosen ideal, that is from you. As the result of his faith, that his chosen ideal has out of his own accord assumed all these forms. You come to know so many secrets that the Lord who is in your heart has taken all these forms, and God is God and Goddesses, so don't hate, don't dislike or like something or dislike something. You may tell, oh, I don't like the aspect of this God, because it is your own chosen ideal, your own Atman which has taken all those forms. So how can you don't like or something like that? So the devout aspirant gradually comes to have also the visions of various divine forms springing from his own chosen ideal. As a result of his faith, that his chosen ideal has out of his own accord assumed all forms. The master used to say, Ramakrishna used to say, he's quoting Sri Ramakrishna, what? A person who has the vision of one such form as a living presence get easily the vision of all other forms. So, thrilling to hear. What are the words of the master? While Sharadananda Ji Maharaj was going forward in spiritual life, master used to, as his guru, guide him. So, what did master tell? What did Sri Ramakrishna tell about this aspect? With his own sweet words of Sri Ramakrishna, we can understand it better, or our faith will be still deeply forced into us, enforced. A person, the words of Sri Ramakrishna are, a person who has the vision of one such form of God or Goddess as a living presence can get easily the vision of all other forms. So thrilling and so wonderful. One thing is clear from what has been said before. Now, two things you should remember here. The basics of spiritual life is you should become non-egoistic, removing our ego is the basics of spiritual life. Don't increase the ego. Don't increase your selfishness. Removing, the more unselfish you become, the more you have removed your ego, the more you are nearer to the realization of God. So, very important thing is downsizing your ego. That is the basics of spiritual life. Then another thing, becoming that another aspect of this is becoming unselfish and unselfish. How will you overgrow? How can you overtake? How can you go forward? By your large-heartedness. That's why, have you grown spiritually? How can you identify whether you have gone spiritually or not? Go and test yourself. Am I become unselfish? Have I reduced my ego? Nobody need not tell you. You yourself can find out how much ego you have. Reduce your ego. You are more nearer to God. Reduce your selfishness. I want everything. I want to get first. I want to enjoy everything. That is selfishness. Remove that. You are more nearer to God. So that is the sign, yardstick of measuring whether you are progressing in spiritual life or not. You need not have any other yardstick. Just like your temperature, because you have to enter something, they will give you the thermo, that measuring thing, an instrument where you can measure your temperature. They will keep it to your head. So it will show the temperature. Likewise, you should have some meter, whether I have grown spiritually or not. What is that? You need not have any external thing. You yourself can measure yourself, your growth, spiritual growth. And what is that? Have I reduced my ego? Have I reduced my selfishness? Do I feel for others? Do I feel for the poor, the needy? Just not feeling is not enough. Am I serving them? Am I doing something for them? Am I trying to ameliorate, reduce the suffering of this world? Then you are progressing in spiritual life. So spiritual life is not static, it is dynamic. You should feel for others. As you progress in spiritual life, you cannot sit quiet when people are suffering. You will rush to help them. So large-heartedness, that's what in large-heartedness and higher spiritual aspirations and realization, there's none other greater than Sharadananda. He's next door. Only go and search all these 14 words. is next only to Swami Vivekananda. Such a person is taking us through, such a great spiritual aspirant, such a great man of realization, one of the greatest direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, is taking us through all these experiences of Bhakti Marga, the path of devotion. So what is correct spiritual path is clearing everything, the doubts. So you can rest assured. Now you can test yourself where we are and how to progress. The Guru is showing us the path. So one thing is clear from what has been said before. What is that? One who has the good fortune to have the vision of such living forms feels that these forms pertaining to the realm of ideas and experience during meditation have as real an existence as things and persons of the waking state. First, I have to tell you again, I have to take through another experiences of David Humphrey, a chemist. So the great scientist David Humphrey, I think Faraday and other people came up in his laboratory. He was working there, in his library, Michael Faraday. There was a librarian looking after the working there for his payment in the library, and he started reading all those books and became great. You know how electricity and other things were in the, some units of electricity have been given to Faraday, Michael Faraday. So he was working in the library of this David Humphrey. So this David Humphrey, while he was a chemist and he was showing the experiment or telling about the nitrous oxide, laughing gas, to his students. Then he inhaled a little more, because in the laboratory you have to bring that gas or liquid and smell it and tell, oh, it is odorless, it has this odor, it has pungent odor, it is a fragrant odor, its odor is like this. So you have to write all the observation in the books. The experiment will be shown to you in the laboratory, in the chemistry, or wherever you have to do the experiments, the trial and error method. You have to test everything, you have to taste it, and so this is of this taste. So in the lab, you have to do all those things. So while experimenting about nitrous oxide, that is NO, there's laughing glass, David Humphrey inhaled a little more gas of it from the jar. And now he lost consciousness. He stood there for a long time. Experimentation class, everything stopped. He just stood there. And after coming out of that state, because his mind was pure, he was a little higher in aspiration than the ordinary people, because he has gone forward by the concentration of the mind due to being a great professor and learning. So he could have that vision because of that inhalation of that gas. In Raja Yoga, it is told you can get the same experience of the higher religious life, spiritual experiences, even by external chemicals too. It is stated in Raja Yoga, Patanjali Maharshi's Raja Yoga, by taking which experience can be got. Now the great scientists are going on to find out by inducing what type of chemicals in the brain you can be made to get that particular spiritual experience. But in Raja Yoga, it is already told, you may get all those experiences, but it will not sustain until unless you have voluntarily trained your mind and you get that experience. If it is forced by some other chemicals, it will not stay for long. You will collapse down. It will be much more dangerous. All those tests have been done by our great yogis and rishis and saints. It's already there. Study Raja Yoga in detail and you will get all those knowledge. So now, all these visions you are going to get. So David Humphrey, when he had that inhaled, that he saw the whole world as ideas. This whole external world disappeared. But he started seeing the whole world as ideas. So I told this experiment and the experience of David Humphrey, because now you can understand here what Sharadananda Maharaj is trying to tell. What is he telling? One thing is clear from what has been said before. One who has the good fortune to have the vision of such living forms feels that these forms pertaining to the realm of ideas. That's why I gave the experiment. He saw that everything is in the form of ideas. And I also last time explained to you with the example of a pot. So many things were there, thousands of years back. That is all destroyed. You know that so many living beings also have got extinct. Dinosaurs are no more. They are extinct. So you can't see a dinosaur now. They may be trying to extract so many things from the chromosomes of the eggs and the other fossils found of the dinosaurs, and they may do it in future, whatever. Now they don't exist. So many living beings like dinosaurs and so many other things of the past era is now gone. But how did you come to know? Because they are still in the form of ideas. They still exist. The form might be lost. The attribute, external attributes might be lost, but they still exist in the form of ideas. So the whole world after dissolution, pralaya, it still exists in the form of ideas. That's why here he's taking us, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling, one who has a good fortune to have the vision of such living forms feels that these forms pertaining to the realm of ideas and experience during meditation have as real an existence as things and persons of the waking state. It is real. They have the existence. They will be in the form of ideas, all these gods and goddesses, the form you are experiencing. Now it is because you meditated on that, it was discovered in your heart, that's all. It will start living in your heart. But as ideas, it is still there. All those forms, all those gods and goddesses, they will be waiting. When you go forward in spiritual life, you will have the vision. They are real. That's what Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling us. As real as in the waking state. Thus, as the feeling deepens that these experiences of the world of ideas are as real as those of the external world, the conviction that the latter also are a projection of the mind, the conviction that the latter, that is us, we people who are the spiritual aspirant, latter also are a projection of the mind, is intensified. Again, during deep meditation, the experiences of the realm of ideas become so powerful in the mind of the devotee that he does not have the slightest knowledge of the external world for the time being. This condition of the devotee has been designated by the scriptures as Savikalpa Samadhi. Savikalpa Samadhi. So now we will stop our discussion about the chapter introduction of the divine incarnation as a spiritual sadhaka. And in that we were looking or studying sadhaka and sadhana. We got so many good things about the spiritual experiences, how a man on the path of devotion is going forward. He gets so many experiences, and we were discussing about that. We will see next Thursday about that. But now we will go to the proper life. Before that, I have to take you through two or three more aspects of the Ashtapashyas, the eight bondages. So now yesterday we were seeing we will finish it off very quickly. Amongst the eight bondages, yesterday we saw about the Kula, caste. Jigupsa was over. We have taken up Kula, the caste. I will take you through that. That is the sixth bondage. Dauhadri, demon, denotes this pride or proud of being related to one's birth. That's called Kula. I'm so proud, the pride in me. That is one of the bondages. Even after listening to Brahmagnana many times, this bondage of birth, this pride does not leave us. It's so deep. Only mother's kindness, that is divine mother or God's kindness, can kill this demon, can break this bondage and free us from the chain. They are also of 100 types. So we have studied about Kula, that is caste. That is one of the eight bondages we have to give up. The next one is Jati, creed. So you have to make the differentiation between Kula, which is caste and jati, creed. So demon Kalkeya denotes it in Durga Saptashati. Due to the false knowledge, Jiva is proud of his body. Due to the false knowledge, Jiva is proud of his body being special. So that is jati, creed. So I will become proud. My pride increases that I belong to this particular group. I have this color, this body. I have these features. I am white in color. I am black in color. I am brown in color. I am different color. I belong to this country. So all that pride is also of another bondage. That is jati, creed. Demon Kalkeya denotes it. Due to false knowledge, Jiva is proud of his body being special. Example, human body. We may be white or black or brown or yellow, but we have different textures of our skin. So I feel either proud of it or I may feel bad about it. So we try to change by external applications, makeups. People who are very white in color, they want to tan their skin color to become dark. And people of other color, they want to become white. And they will put so many applications to get that. So both the things that you like, your body features, your body texture and your body, your nature, your the where you are born. And some people don't like it, both hatred and love of that things, the pride in the positive and the negative things is also a bondage. It will not allow us to get the real knowledge of Brahman, which will bind us and pull us down. So this bondage is very powerful. What is that? Jati, creed, very powerful. And no theoretical knowledge of God. We read now so many things. So that knowledge is intellectual knowledge, theoretical knowledge. But unless we experience God, the knowledge of God, this bondage cannot be removed. So any amount of theoretical knowledge of God cannot remove this. So you have to have the experience within. Just like we went through the sadhaka and sadhana, when we start experiencing God in our heart, then only this bondage can be removed to some extent. So that is what being told about this Ashtapasha, one of the Ashtapasha, the seventh one. So finally, the last pasha. Now before that, there is something to be told about this seventh one. There's a creed. So human soul is reborn again and again, mainly due to this bondage. They are also of 100 types. What is that bondage we were looking through? That is the jati, creed, the seventh one. So human soul is reborn again and again, mainly due to this bondage. They are also of 100 types. Now the eighth bondage, the last and final bondage is Shila. It's a very good thing. We also are named as Sushila, Shilavan. All those things, names will be given. So it is very good. But it is also a bondage. So how we will see? How we have to overcome that? Shila or modesty. This bondage is denoted by demon Maurya. Modesty means nature of Jiva. What is meant by modesty? It means nature of Jiva. An idea Jiva makes about himself. Modesty, he means nature of Jiva. An idea Jiva or a living being or we make about ourselves. An idea Jiva makes about himself and the universe. Both about himself and the universe during the cause of his many births. He has undergone so many births. Because of all those impressions, we have some idea about ourselves, about our individuality, about our my nature, and also of this external world. So that is called Shila, modesty. This bondage is also called Rudragranti. Especially in the Divine Mother worship, we have so many things called, just like Chandi here, we have another great thing in South India, almost propagated by Shankaracharya, great Acharya. What is that? Lalita Sahasranama. So in that Lalita Trishati, Lalita Tripuri Sundari, in that Vidya, Sri Vidya, it's called Sri Vidya. So the tantras or the scriptures in North India propagating this Chandi and other aspects has different connotation there. Here, Sri Vidya is another little different nature. There, in that Sri Vidya or in the Lalita Sahasranama, we have a term called Vishnu Granthi Vibhedini, Rudra Granthi Vibhedini, Lalita Sahasranama. You get that as you go forward and forward, higher and higher in spiritual things, all these bondages are cut asunder by Divine Mother or by God. So, Vishnu Granthi, after Vishnu Granthi, the final Granthi is Rudra Granthi. Granthi means here the bondage, the knot. So, there for the Pasha, your Pasha means you have been bound by that thread or tether. But here the name is given as Granthi. Granthi means knot. That knot has bound you. The same thing in a different name, that's all. So, whatever the term there as, it's called as Rudra Granthi. Even after attaining higher stages of spirituality, one is not from this bondage. So even after attaining higher stage of spirituality, one is not liberated from this bondage, that is modesty or Shila. And only after removal of this bondage, one is established in Advaita or union with God. So removal of this bondage is not easy. Only, so yesterday I had a question, how to overcome this bondage? How to break all this bondage? Now you are getting the answer. Yesterday I told that spiritual aspirant to wait. I'm coming to that. So now you can see only God or God sent Guru. Only God or God sent Guru. So your Guru, only your Guru and God can remove this final bondage from the jiva. All other bondages may be due to your personal endeavor or personal self-effort. To some extent, you might remove those things. That also we need God's grace and Guru's grace. But this one, you cannot remove by your self-effort. You have to pray to Lord only, and your Guru only can do that. So God sent Guru, the Guru who has initiated you, and God. Only God or God sent Guru can remove this final bondage from the jiva, from the living being, that is from you or me. Without removing these eight bondages, jiva cannot know his real nature, that is the self, Atman, that is you are of the nature of God. People may try to do many types of sadhana, spiritual practices, but these sadhanas sometimes further strengthen the bondages. That's why I told yesterday one spiritual aspirant, don't go on doing so many spiritual sadhanas. Okay, in the beginning when you have not got a guru, they're all good. But once you have got a guru, the Lord has sent you one guru and given you the mantra and the way to do the sadhana. Please don't deviate from that. Once you have got it from guru, stick on to that. Try to dig the well at one place. Our nature of our mind is, that's why we need the necessity of a guru is to give us faith. We will take up one spiritual practice and do some days and we get some happiness, go on. Then after some times, when there is a breakage or hurdle, when you can't go forward, give up that and take up another practice. So like that, we go on shifting practices of our practices and practices of after practices. We will not make progress in any place. Ramakrishna used to give the example of digging the well. Or now here in South Africa, the term well and other things are not known. So even if I tell digging the well, they may not understand. So to get water in India, the farmers or those people to get whatever drinking water, they used to take recourse to the groundwater. So they used to remove the groundwater in a big way and water would get collected there as you go deeper and deeper, just like we do in the bore well now, boreholes. In South Africa, they call it boreholes. So there in India, it's called bore wells. So in olden days, all those machineries were not there to put on the bore wells or bore holes. So they used to dig well, go deeper and deeper. and build the walls there, and the water gets collected, the underground water will come and get collected. It's called well. So now that digging of the well, you start doing at one place, then somebody will come and tell you, who told you to dig the well here? No, you cannot find water here. I'm an expert in the soil science. So go, I know the best. You come here, I'll show you here. He will take you and tell him that this is the place you have to dig the well. He goes on digging another 20 feet there. Another person tells, oh, this is not the right place. I know that person is a, hypocrite. He doesn't know anything about this water, underground water. I know very well. You dig, this is not the place. Come here, I'll show you another place. Like that, many people will be telling so many things. You go on digging the well 20 feet, 30 feet, 40 feet at different places, and you will not get water anywhere. Then Ramakrishna tells, if you had dug the well in the first place where you started, where you left for 30 feet, all the other effort which you have put, 20 feet here, 30 feet there, 40 feet there, 60 feet there, or maybe in so many other places, if you had dug in the same place where you started, then you would have already got the water. You have wasted your time. So don't go on shifting your spiritual practices. Today vipassana, then another meditation, and sahaja marga, so many other margas. Take up whichever. I don't tell that should not be taken up. If you have taken up one, go on in that. Don't go on deviating. But now, since the guru has given you the diksha and shown you the path, don't get deviated. Just take the knowledge from all the other things. You can make use of it, but do not deviate from the path given by your guru. Go on doing in that. That's the reason why we take the help of the guru. Because of this doubting mind, it goes on changing the paths, and we will not get reach our goal anywhere. It may derail our mind too. That's why just go on what the guru tells. Don't deviate and go and get some other instructions and go on doing that. You'll be in trouble. So you've got, I think yesterday's question I answered in these two things. People may try to do many types of sadhanas, but these sadhanas sometimes further, if you go on changing sadhanas like that, today this one, tomorrow transcendental meditation, day after tomorrow another meditation, day after other things, if you go on changing like that, people may try to do many types of sadhana, but these sadhanas sometimes further strengthen these bondages. Instead of going deeper into spiritual life, then you will be pulled out. We have to remember one thing, that moksha, bondages, both this moksha, the liberation and bondage, both are in fact imaginary. Getting out of bondage, one would find that there was nothing called moksha or bondage, and one was already free. Then what is the way out to get ourselves free from these pashas? So now, to understand this concept that we are not at all bound, we were free all the time, but we were imagining. Even now, I am imagining that I am this body. You are imagining you are this body-mind complex. You are ego. You are the mind. You are imagining with that individuality. So that's all imagination. You have been hypnotized to think so. Just like I will give you the example of one donkey. The donkey was being taken by the owner, and while going to another place, he had to stop somewhere, because in those days it was all walking. So they had to stop somewhere in the forest. So the owner of the donkey had forgotten to bring the big rope to tie that donkey to a tree or plant or a stump. So now he was finding it difficult. Now if I leave this donkey loose, let it loose or keep it there without tying, then it will go away somewhere. Then I have to go in search of the donkey. I'll be in trouble. So he was searching for something, a tether or rope, and here he couldn't find. Another passerby, another traveler told, what are you doing? Searching rope for a donkey. Don't worry. You just go to the donkey and act as if you have a rope and you have tied it. You act, just act, do all the action. And for take the donkey as if you are taking the thread, long thread, and tying it to a tree, knot it, push the donkey like this, it cannot move, do all that action and come. That's all. You need not have a thread at all or a rope. then the person followed it. He went, took the donkey near the tree, as if the rope, it was a very small rope tied to its neck. So as if he pulled that big and tried, went around, the, it's all action. It was acting. So went around the tree, tied it nicely, put a knot, and made the donkey to stay there. So the donkey felt, yes, I have been tied, and it was standing there. It was standing there the whole night. Morning he got up. This person knows that he has not tied it, it is only, he acted like he's tied. Then he was about to go and call the donkey, come, let us go, follow me. The donkey is still standing there. It is not moving at all. Then the another person who had met him there, he told, no, what are you doing, foolish man? Yesterday you have tied the donkey, so it thinks that it is still bound. So it will not move, even if you call, even if you pull it, it will not come. It will stand there itself, thinking that I've been tied. You go do the acting of untying again. Then the donkey will feel I've been untied and it will come. So he went there. He did the untying of the rope. He acted. There was no rope, nothing. It was standing there, feeling that I've been tied, I've been in bondage. And he then called it. Then the donkey started running behind him. So like that, this donkey, the maya, the avidya, the ignorance, we are feeling that we are bound. We are having all these bondages. But in reality, we are that highest being. Where is the question of bondage? You have been hypnotized. All this sadhana, all these spiritual practices is to remove that idea that you are bound. That's all. Nothing else. So there is no bondage. There is no liberation. We are imagining. We have been hypnotized to think that we are bound. So that's why, like the donkey, we are thinking we are bound. I am the body, I am the mind, and just staying there, enjoying this puny world. But you are the emperors. You are the children of immortality. You are the children of God. But we are thinking that we are ordinary beings and bound in this. So that is bondage and that is liberation. So you got the clear idea. So that hypnotization is so strong, just like the donkey, we have to remove that. Getting out of bondage, one would find that there was nothing called bondage or moksha. You are always free. All the time you are free. You are free. You are now free. You have that eternal freedom, but we have forgotten it. We have hypnotized to think that we don't have freedom. We are ordinary beings. Then what is the way out to get ourselves free from these pashas? It is not easy to get rid of these pashas. In Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, verse 59, Bhagavan Krishna tells, now we are doing 57th verse, the 58th. Verse in the second chapter. I'll come to the next, this thing on the next Wednesday, 59. What is there Krishna is telling in that second chapter, 59th verse? Bhagavan Krishna tells, Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehinaha rasavarjam rasopyasya parandrushtva nivartate. The abstentious embodied soul, of course, keeps the sensuous objects, keeps away from the sensuous objects, but not necessarily the relish for them. So now you may give up food, you may give up all the sense enjoyments, you may be abstentious, remove that all those things from you. But how will you remove the internal feelings which is in the mind, the liking, the relish for them? That is causing the internal enemy. The enemy is within, it's not outside. So that has to be removed. Your thought has to be removed. Your imagination has to be removed. That is important. So that's what Krishna is telling. You may give up food. But once you take food again, that will come back because it's in your mind, deeper in your mind. But to remove from there that the thought level. So parandrashtva nivartate. What is Krishna telling there? If you realize God, if you go nearer to God, then all these bondages will automatically be removed. It is so easy to remove. Is it so easy to remove the 8 chains divided into 720 types? So what is the way out then? Yes, there is one way. Complete surrender to God. Complete surrender to Divine Mother, as in Durga Saptashati. God, we think of mother or father or whatever way you want, any God you like. So complete surrender to Divine Mother or God is the only way out. Surrender, Sharanagati. If we like like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is showing us now as an avatar, present our whole being to Mother. We will see that these demons come forward. All these demons, all these pashas, all these bondages, they are all demons, different demons, will come forward and present themselves to the Mother for sacrifice, being killed on the altar of your yajna of bhakti, devotion, and liberate our soul. So if you surrender to Mother, if you pray to Mother, if you pray to your Ishta Devata God, whether Vishnu or Shiva or Divine Mother, whatever you like, then what will happen? I'm only taking the name of Mother here because from Durga Saptashati. So just like if we, Ramakrishna has shown the path, surrender, complete surrender to Divine Mother, like that, if you pray, like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, we present our whole being to Mother, we surrender to God, we will see that all these demons, the pashas, the bondages, will of themselves come forward and present themselves to the Mother for the sacrifice, for being cut asunder, khandana, where on the altar of your yajna, the havan, the yajna of bhakti, devotion, and liberate our souls. So we have got how to remove the bondages, all the 8 bondages. Now we will go to the proper life. I think many of our questions have been answered here. Now we will go to the life of Sri Ramakrishna, where we are left in the last class. So Ramakrishna is telling about himself, the spiritual sadhana he was doing at the time. He's with his own sacred mouth or lips, he's telling all those things. What is Sri Ramakrishna is telling? There was then an intolerable anguish in my heart because I could not have the vision of Divine Mother. Just as a man wrings a towel forcefully to squeeze out all the water from it, I felt as if somebody got hold of my heart and mind and was wringing them. Likewise, gradually afflicted with the thought that I might never have Mother's vision, I was in great agony. I thought that there was no use in living such a life, this life of vegetation, just like a vegetable, living such a useless life, life of sense gratification, just being in this world. I didn't like that idea, to live such a ordinary life without the vision of God, without realizing the truth. I was in great agony. I thought that there was no use in living such a life. My eyes suddenly fell upon the sword that was there in the Mother's temple. Generally, there will be that sword, big sword will be there to sacrifice the goat and other animals to the Divine Mother. So that sacrificial sword will be kept there to sacrifice different animals. So that sword was lying there. So Ramakrishna saw that sword. I thought that there was no use in living such a life. My eyes suddenly fell upon the sword that was there in the Mother's temple. I'd made my mind up to end my life with that very moment. Like one mad, I ran and caught hold of that sword and was about to cut off my head, when suddenly I had the wonderful vision of the Mother. And fell down unconscious. I did not know what happened then in the external world. But how that day and night slipped away. The whole day, the night, everything slipped away. He's not aware of it at all in the external world, what has happened in that day and night, maybe more than 24 hours. But in my heart, but what is happening within? The external world is gone. But what is happening within Sri Ramakrishna now, when he had the vision of Divine Mother? But in my heart of hearts, there was flowing a current of intense bliss. In the heart of my heart, Ramakrishna is telling, there was flowing a current of intense bliss, never experienced before. And I had the immediate knowledge of the light that is Mother. Ramakrishna is telling, I had the immediate knowledge of the light that is mother. On another occasion, the master described to us in great detail his wonderful vision mentioned above. He said, it was as if the house, the doors, the temples, and all other things vanished altogether. Because he is in the sanctum, the Garbhagriha, sanctum sanctorum. So all the other things, the walls, the doors of that, in the Dakshineshwar, the sanctum, if you go there, you can see it now. So Ramakrishna was there doing the worship of the Divine Mother. So at that time, he had this vision when he wanted to end that life, useless life, which has not realized truth. So on another occasion, Master described to us in details his wonderful vision mentioned above. Ramakrishna said, it was as if the houses, the doors, the temples, and all other things vanished altogether when he had that vision. As if there was nothing anywhere. And what I saw was a boundless, infinite, conscious sea of light. And what I saw was a boundless, infinite, conscious sea of light. You might be wondering that you might have the vision of Divine Mother, Kali. So who is Kali? Who is all the different forms? Shiva, Vishnu. Finally, you come to that. So he didn't have the figure of the Divine Mother here. What was the experience Sri Ramakrishna is having? All the forms vanished. Then what is the vision he is having? It was as if the house, doors, temples, and all the other things vanished altogether. And as if there was nothing anywhere. And what I saw was a boundless. Boundless means akhanda, endless. You cannot bind it, you cannot cut it. Boundless. Infinite. Same words in different expression. Boundless, you cannot bind it. We were all talking about bondage. Yes, now, astapasha means bondages. So that which is boundless, if you experience that, then where is the question of bondage? So boundless, infinite. It's not finite, infinite. Conscious, pure consciousness. Sea of light. Ramakrishna is having that vision. Everything vanished, and I saw a boundless, infinite consciousness, sea of light. However far, and in whatever direction I looked, I found a continuous succession of effulgent waves of light coming forward. However far, and in whatever direction I looked, I found a continuous succession of effulgent waves coming forward, raging and storming from all sides with great speed. Very soon they fell upon me and made me sink in the abysmal depths of infinity. I panted and struggled as it were and lost all sense of external consciousness. The master told us that at that time he saw a luminous sea of consciousness. The master told that, Ramakrishna is telling that, at that time, he saw a luminous sea of consciousness. But what about the Divine Mother's form? What about the Divine Mother's form? Consisting of pure consciousness only. The form of hers with hands that give boons and freedom from fear. What happened to that form? Did the master then have the vision of that form also in that sea of light? It appears that he had. For as soon as he had the slightest consciousness, at the time of his first vision, we are told, uttered repeatedly the word mother, 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 in a voice choked by emotion. So we can imagine he might have had it. But Ramakrishna has not told that. He's telling that he could see only that sea, unbound sea of consciousness, light, effulgent, luminous, everywhere. He has not mentioned anything about form. Here Shardanandaji Maharaj is imagining that you might have seen that form with the hands and that form of the Divine Mother, because as soon as he came out of that state, he uttered repeatedly the word Mother, Mother, in a voice choked by emotion. When that vision came to an end, there arose in the heart of the Master, when after that vision came to an end, there arose in the heart of the Master an eager, incessant urge and aspiration for a constant, immediate vision of the Divine Mother's form. Now, the desire to have the vision didn't stop. The moment it had that seen that, you cannot keep quiet. So the mind is again and again aspiring to see the vision of the Divine Mother constantly. When that vision came to an end, there arose in the heart of the Master an eager, incessant urge and aspiration for a constant, immediate vision of the Divine Mother's form, consisting of consciousness only. Although it was not always manifested in external symptoms like weeping, etc., it always existed in his heart. Sometimes it increased so much that, unable to suppress it, he fell on the ground and struggled in pain. He wept so much, saying, "Bestow thy grace on me, Mother, and show thyself to me," that people gathered all around him. Not even a shade of concern for what they would think of such restlessness arose in his mind at that time. People are gathered around him while he had fallen down on the ground and panting and crying for Mother, for vision, another vision. He was shouting, he was crying just like the baby cries for the mother. People gathered around him and were looking at him. But he was not aware of what the outer external things are. So now you can see absence of lajja, the bondage called lajja, shame. No idea of shame at all. No lajja, the bondage of lajja. Let thousands of people gather. Who is bothered? I am bothered only about my mother. That is the focus. That is concentration. Let people tell anything. They are bound to tell. They will criticize you. But I have been focused on my goal and my life. Let people tell anything. He wept so much, saying, "Bestow thy grace on me, Mother, and show thyself to me," that people gathered all round him. Not even a shade of concern for what they would think of such restlessness arose in his mind at that time. He used to say, although people stood all around, they appeared unreal, like shadows or pictures painted on canvas, and not even the slightest sense of shame or hesitation did cross my mind on that score. So it's very, very important that how to overcome lajja, these bondages. Again, Krishna told there, Vishaya vinivartante nirahārasya dehnaha rasavarjam rasopyasya parandrishtva nivartate. All that attraction, all these bondages will go away when you go nearer to God. So now his focus is only on Divine Mother, his Ishtadevata, whatever may be your Ishtadevata. Focus on that. Forget about what people are telling about you. Just focus on that. Just concentrate. How should be the concentration? Then there will be no lajja. There will be no shame. No question of shame. I and my Divine Mother. I and my God. I and my Ishtadevata. That's all. God and me, nothing else. So let people tell whatever they want. Ramakrishna couldn't even, they were like shadows. People, all those who had gathered and they were sympathizing or somewhere criticizing, looking at his pathetic condition, falling on the ground and calling, "Mother, Mother, show thyself to me." So now we will think, even before going to the temple, we will see this side and that side. Anybody watching me? I have read signs, and if somebody looks at me and think that I'm going to the temple, they may think that I'm superstitious. So if nobody is watching, then I will enter the temple. Otherwise, I will come away. Or to do pranams to our father and mother, to do namaskar to God, we will see, is anybody watching me? They should not feel that I am a superstitious person. going down to God. So to put some mark on the head or eat some prasad, you'll see here and there, is anybody watching? If nobody is watching, eat it or do that, put on the mark. And after that, come out. If nobody should see, rub off all the marks on the head. So ours is such condition. That is a bondage which is not allowing us to go. Lajja, shame. You feel shamed, ashamed. What will the other people think? What will those people think? It's all imagination. They don't have time to think about you. They have their own concerns and worries. Who will think of you? Who has time to think of all you and your things? They are bothered about their life and problems. They have so many problems to face. Who will think of you? It is all your imagination. That's why everything, all these eight bondages are in your own mind. You have been dressed like the donkey. You have been made to think like that. You have been hypnotized to think like that. So now here you can see, because the intensity, parandrushtva nivartate. If you are aspiring to see the Lord, the truth, whatever, whichever goal it may be. Just like see the case of Arjuna. All other, so many princes were there who were practicing archery. Just like Arjuna, Duryodhana, Dushasana, and many other, even Dharmaraya, Bhima, everybody were practicing archery and arms under Dronacharya. So now they were asked to aim at the target. So all were asked to shoot that bird, imaginary bird. They used to keep some bird on the tree, and they used to ask the guru, ask them to shoot them. So now everybody are ready with the arrow, aim at that bird. Then Dronacharya started asking, what do you see? Then the other archers were there, just like the other princes were, they started telling, I can see the green foliage, the branches, the bird and everything. All were telling, explaining about the other things. When he came to Arjuna, Arjuna was asked, what do you see there? So what is your aim? The guru had told the archer, the greatest archer, that is Dronacharya, the guru had told, focus, you have to hit the eye of that bird. So now Arjuna's focus was so much so that he told, what do you see now? He is not even seeing the bird, let alone all the branches and trees and all other things. Arjuna was telling, I see only the eyes. I can see only the eyes of that bird. I'm not even seeing the bird, the feathers and other things. I can see only the eyes of that bird, that's all. The guru had asked him to shoot the eye. So he couldn't see anything. Focus, see that focus. He was not bothered about how the body of the bird looks or anything. My guru has told me, focus on the eye, just on the eye. That is the concentration. So where is the question of thinking about this world? When you focus on God, when you focus on the reality. So that should be the focus. You can see, we can learn from Ramakrishna how we should focus on spiritual life. How we should give up all this lajja. What will people other think? So let them think, let the world think. Let corona or anything come and do whatever it want. I will focus on God. My parandrushtva nivartate. If you see God, all your fears will be gone. Focus on God and all fears vanish. That's what Ramakrishna is showing through that vision. While he is aspiring, panting for mother, people are gathered around him. Some people are criticizing, some people are sympathizing. But Ramakrishna is telling, not even a shade of concern for what they would think of such restlessness arose in his mind at that time. He used to say, although people stood all around, they appeared unreal like shadows or pictures painted on canvas. And not even the slightest sense of shame, lajja, or hesitation did cross my mind on that score. So your question is being answered. How to give up all the bondages? Go nearer and nearer to God. Focus on God. They will be left behind. So we shall stop our discussion here and we will continue our discussion in the next class. So now it's already nearing 8 o'clock, another 5 minutes. So now we can go for the question and answer session. If you have any questions, if you have any doubts, you can please ask. Then I'll try to clear if that's the will of the Lord.
Pranam.
Pranam, who is it?
This is Anil.
Please tell Anil.
I'm able to understand. Thank you, Madan.
That's wonderful. Any other questions or any other doubts about that which we have discussed today? If you don't have any other doubts or questions, I can wind up the discussion with the prayer. Does anybody has any questions? Okay, I will end the session with the prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshah Sarvayagneshwaro Harihi Tasmin Tushte Jagat Tushtam प्रीणिते प्रीणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु। We will meet on next Thursday. Then we will have the same class on Thursday and Friday, Sunday and Monday. So today is Monday evening. We have the Puja class, the Science of Worship, at 6 o'clock here, South African time, and it will be 9:30 in Indian time. So we will be discussing about the different processes, the rituals of Puja, the science of worship and significance of worship. Tomorrow evening we have Tuesday, that is Viveka Chudamani, the manual text of Vedanta written by Shankaracharya, Question Level of Discrimination. Then we have on Wednesday, the Bhagavad Gita. That's what today we have quoted, the Vishya Vinvartante Niraharasya Dehinaha. We are now discussing about the 58th verse. So we will continue with the discussion of that and then go to the next verse. So that is Wednesday evening, we have the Gita class. Then Thursday, Friday morning, we have again the discussion of Great Master. Then Saturday, we have again Bhagavad Gita discussion in the evening. So Sunday, Monday, again, the great master discussion. So all are welcome to all these classes. Then on Sunday at about 9:30, we have the Hinduism for Children classes, where the children are taught about Hinduism and different aspects of Hinduism, and Sanskrit language is also being taught. So all are welcome for all this discussion. Thank you. Namaste. Jai Shri Ramakrishna. Om Namo Narayanaya.